I am Christine Jacobs. I'm the Executive Director of Represent, and I know I think I've met almost every one of you. And we have with us today Senator Maria Collette. And as Teresa said, some of you met Maria in Teresa's kitchen. And when she was running for the Senate, we endorsed her last time. And I'll never forget a conversation I had with Maria where we had a lot less money last time. And I called and I think I told her we were giving her $8,000 in the spring. And she said, oh my God, I can pay for 2.5 mailings with that. And then with that, she brought in more money and she's a state senator. And our other person we have here today is Morgan Cephas. And Morgan is in Philadelphia and she's been working for you for a number of years. And what I like about both of these women is that you may not know them, you may not talk to them regularly, but when you hear them, you'll know that they're working hard for you. And that's what's really important. You know, we tend to take a statewide look at things in Represent. You can like your own state representative. You can, you know, hey, I'm having trouble with my permit for something. I'll call constituent services and I'll get something done. But really, when you look at what the legislature does, they're acting for all of Pennsylvania. And so Represent takes a statewide look at all of the candidates running in Pennsylvania and decides where a smart investment can put in a progressive woman and really bring change. We really believe that the Pennsylvania legislature is failing all of its citizens. You know, I've thrown a few of my favorite statistics on here. But, you know, first I want to start with, do you know that the first time that our environment and energy group within the House ever talked about climate change was this year, and they brought in a climate change denier? The only time that's ever been brought up in this committee. We treat our residents, a lot of discussion now about equity in our society. We treat our residents very unequally across this state. Pennsylvania college students graduate with the highest amount of debt in the country. Pennsylvania elementary and high school funding is the most unequal between rich and poor school districts in the entire country. And Pennsylvania is one of only 21 states that still use a federal minimum wage of $7.25 an hour, and the only one in the Northeast that does that. None of these things are acceptable, and all of these things can change, but they won't change unless we get a different legislature. But why do we focus on women? Well, you know, until the 2018 election, Pennsylvania ranked 49th in terms of when you look at the share of women in elected office. My joke always used to be, thank God for Mississippi, because otherwise we would have been 50th. The good news is we're now 40th in this rank, but not good enough. Institutional sexism is at play by both parties. We didn't get to be 49th by only the Republicans. You know, the Democratic Party was fully complicit in this. And that's why Represent exists, is to be outside the party structure. When you look at it, and this is part of what drew Teresa to our work, is women haven't exercised their political power. They haven't voted with their purses. They haven't been the ones who are making decisions about who they would give money to. And they haven't consistently supported each other. And women's candidates have been ignored by many of the current power brokers. We at Represent really believe strongly in a reflective democracy. That's not just a representative democracy, a reflective democracy, which means that when you look at the legislature as a whole, we want it to look like all of our citizens. We want it to look like all of us in terms of race, gender, religion, age, educational background, what kind of skills you bring. And so as you listen to both Maria and Morgan tonight, you'll see two very different skill sets, two very different backgrounds. But together, it's beautiful music. And that's why we're trying to put together a reflective democracy. You know, since we've been around since 2014, and we didn't raise a lot of money in those early years, and we didn't have much of an impact. I talked about overall elected jobs for women. This is our national ranking in terms of where we rank among all the state legislatures in the country. Going into the 2018 elections, we ranked 39th. We had 19.4% women. And we invested $200,000 that year, and I think we made a difference in a number of races. We now rank 32nd with 26.5% women. But this year we're going up over, we're gonna be over 400. I think we were talking today about how we're gonna get to 450, and I think that's quite feasible to do. It's a lot of money, but it's feasible to do. And what's really good is we have such wonderful candidates. And when you meet them and you talk to them and you kind of go, I wish we could give them more. But we know that if we can do above $400,000 this year, we will really move the needle on this one. You know, we're going to be working on this till we hit our 50%. Money has really made the difference. It's ugly. No one likes talking about it. I hate it. But do you know Pennsylvania has absolutely no campaign limits? Do you know how much money pours into the state legislative offices from the oil and gas industry in this state? It's horrendous. And we need to elect good people who will change those laws for a fairer society. I'm not going to read through this one. This is just our list of these are all these wonderful women we supported in the pre-primary. And some of them have some pretty tough races coming up. In the Senate, we have one reelect. Pam Iovino's seat's going to be a really tough fight. We have six new candidates, five red to blue flips, and six, if you count Amanda Cappelletti, newly with women, and one woman running to replace a retiring Democrat. We have 17 reelects that we're working on in the House. Some are safe, some have more serious challengers. We have 17 brand new candidates, and 17 of those, all 17 would be red to blue flips, and 10 of them newly with women. The other seven are we want to support a Democratic woman running to replace a Republican woman. And one is running to replace a retiring woman. And we want to invest, this says 400,000. I think it's going to be 450. Right, Peggy? I know you're on here. Right, Peggy? Our 2020 candidates did really well in the primaries. We go through a process. We figure out who might win. We look at a particular district. We go through an analysis. For example, in the Erie, we supported Julie Slomski in the race for Senate. She had two competitors who both discounted her. She was the only woman running in that. And we fully believe that Julie's going to take her place next to Maria in the Senate this year. Just a super candidate. But we made the difference. She will tell anybody that our money to her enabled her to go on TV. And if it hadn't been for Represents money, it wouldn't happen. Another person we're looking to put in the Senate is Janet Diaz. Janet Diaz is in Lancaster County. She was not supported by the Lancaster Democratic Party because, well, you know, she might not have been the best candidate. She didn't fit into their mold. They had a nice guy to run for that seat. Janet Diaz, we were half of the money she raised in her primary. She ran a very lean primary, but she won with a lot of grassroots support and the fact that she would be the first Latina in the legislature. And now the as Maria knows, once you get through the first processes, then the Senate Democratic Committee seizes upon you and helps you. But first you've got to prove yourself as a viable candidate. And we're so proud that Janet tells everybody. Her comment to me after the primary was, "You guys believed in me and we did it together." And every time I say that, I start to cry. So anyway, on to the general elections. When Teresa and I were talking about what we wanted to do in today's discussion, she said, well, you know, my people are pretty well informed. They stay on top of the news. They're also smart, creative. But there's two issues that I think we want to talk about. One of the issues we want to talk about is what's going on with the virus. How do we feel that the Pennsylvania is responding in general? And we thought Maria Collette would be a great person, first because she's come back to us, second, she's formerly a nurse. And I think that gives her, again, reflective democracy. Isn't it nice when you're having these discussions about how to allocate funds, there's somebody with a medical background who can be part of that discussion. And also we wanted to invite Maria because she's now been a year and a half in the state Senate. So how's it going? Is it anything like you thought it would be?
Well, I have to tell you, first, I want to thank you, Teresa, for hosting us, for Chris, for inviting me to speak, and of course, to Represent for hosting this evening's event. And I know that everyone on the call knows how critically important it is that we have the opportunity to meet and discuss the issues that Chris was referring to. We need to get everyone as energized as we are about the change that we can make in our legislature. For those of you that haven't met me before, and I do remember that evening in your kitchen, Teresa, where I was so nervous because I knew how much was at stake. And let me tell you, tonight I am no less nervous because there is so much still at stake for our Commonwealth. And so I am really, really excited to be here with you all today. I am Senator Maria Collette. I represent Pennsylvania's 12th District. That's parts of Montgomery and Bucks counties. And to answer your question that kicked us off here, I want to say that the Senate has been different from what I expected, but it has really been my incredible honor and privilege to serve the people of my community every day for the past 19 months. I have learned so much about this community and how I can be effective in representing their interests every day. One of the things that so many of us say often, those of us that are fortunate enough to serve in the legislature, is that we believe that everyone is there trying to do the best for the people they represent. And although we may differ in what we think the best thing is, our hearts are all in the right place. You can tell I say that with a little tongue in cheek there. One of the things that I have really had to learn is that partisan politics is alive, well, and thriving in Harrisburg. And let me tell you, I do not say that lightly. It was my sincere hope that my fellow public servants really were more reasonable and collaborative than the rhetoric out there tells us. In the short 19 months that I have been there, I have seen such a lack of bipartisanship that it often feels defeating. And I knew this was a numbers game going in. I'm not naive. But I did believe that there was a stronger sense of service among my fellow electeds, a stronger sense that we were all in this for the greater good, that our communities could really benefit from if we could put party politics aside and work together. So that's one of the things that we all hear so much about government, isn't it? That there's gridlock, partisanship, distrust, because so many of our electeds are no longer there to serve, but because they have a good job. So you asked me, you know, is it what I expected? No. And would it have made a difference for me to enter in the majority party of our legislature? Undoubtedly. I don't know how much everyone on this call knows about the way that things move in Harrisburg, but the majority party does control every aspect of how legislation is moved to the governor's desk, what committee it's assigned to, whether the bill is brought up in committee for a vote even, whether even if it's been voted out of committee, it ever is brought up on the floor for a vote. And then if it makes it through one chamber of the legislature, the majority party in the other chamber makes all of those decisions over again. So good law is often beholden to the whim of the majority party. And that's why I really am excited to be here with all of you this evening to talk about these issues. It is critical. Critical that people who want to serve, who want to make our communities and our Commonwealth a better place for all Pennsylvanians are elected. I'm honored, as you've heard, to be a Represent success story. I know that with the help I received from Represent, I am sitting here today to make a difference for not only the people in my community, but as Chris said, for the people around our Commonwealth. And I know that with Represent's support, we'll welcome an even more incredible group of committed women to our state Senate. You heard some of their names already. Women like Amanda Cappelletti, Carolyn Comita, Janet Diaz, Julie Slonsky, Shanna Danielson. I could go on and on. I am so excited to say that including the incumbent women we have running in our Democratic caucus, there are 11 Democratic women running for state Senate this time around. It is an incredible group of people, mothers, educators, business owners, activists, environmentalists, and the biggest thing of all, public servants. These are women that I cannot wait to welcome into my chamber and into my caucus. They are the women that will flip our Senate and bring voices with a strong commitment to community back into government. And you heard that before I came to the legislature, I was a nurse. I still am a nurse, but I worked as a nurse. And I can tell you right now that that commitment to community and to public service would have been welcome as we face this pandemic. I worked in infection control. I worked in a nursing home as a level one trauma nurse, but more recently I worked as an infection control nurse in a nursing home in Bucks County. So I have some understanding of what our frontline workers have been facing and how critical it is that we follow scientific guidance and protocols that can keep our communities safe. I wear a mask when I'm out so that I can protect grocery store workers who are essential, so that I can protect nurses who are essential, so that I can protect transport workers who are essential. I wear my mask to protect elderly community members, my immune compromised neighbors and family and everyone around me. And I have to tell you that having legislators stand on the floor of the Senate without masks, lecturing our Department of Health Secretary, Dr. Rachel Levine, about effective infection prevention strategies would be funny if the results of what they were arguing for weren't so tragic. As a nurse, I am appalled at the disregard for science in the face of this pandemic. I have fought just as hard as my colleagues to protect people's livelihoods throughout this, but I am distraught to hear my colleagues arguing for livelihoods over lives. I am distraught to hear colleagues fighting for feelings over science. Those are the same legislators who argued that people can be trusted to act appropriately without guidance from the governor and our Department of Health. They're the same ones who refused to wear masks in our Capitol and who failed to inform House members when one of their own tested positive for COVID and had to quarantine. We've just learned today, as a matter of fact, that two Senate staffers have also been in contact with COVID positive people. And we are now looking at our protocols and contact tracing to see if they came in contact with any of our staffers and senators who have been up in Harrisburg. And so I have to tell you that I will end there because I think you're getting the message of what I'm trying to say. But my call to action to you all this evening, as Chris has said, is, you know, for tonight and over the next 5 months, I want you to support Represent. They will help us get effective public servants elected to join our legislature to turn things around. And with their help, we will continue our fight. And I think that we will achieve the results that we're hoping for to really craft a Pennsylvania that works for all of us. I cannot wait to welcome them. And I don't want to speak for her, but I know that Representative Cephas is going to be excited to welcome them as well. So thank you all so much for having me here this evening. I am so excited to be here to talk with you, even though it's on Zoom. I know that we'll get to a point where we're all meeting in person again, but the fact that we're able to do this in this time, in this moment, tonight, really means the world to me, and it means the world to all of those women who are running for office who really do need your support to help them get across the finish line, just like I did. I am so excited to be serving in our state legislature and to be able to come here this evening to tell you about the incredible impact that the women that Represent helped elect in 18 and before are doing an incredible job representing the people of our Commonwealth and fighting to make sure that we only do that much more to improve our Commonwealth so that it really is a state that is working for all Pennsylvanians. So thank you again. I'm excited to be here. I can't wait to stick around and hear what Representative Cephas has to say about our budget process and to answer any questions that come up. Thank you again for having me.
Thank you, Maria. I you know, Teresa, I don't know about you, but I'm remembering watching Maria in your kitchen, and I'm in about tears right now because this is the essence of Represent, where we take women who've got a goal, they've got a desire, they want to be public servants, they want to do something, and we help make that happen. So that Maria, who'd started with the SDCC and then thinking, well, you know, does she really have a path to victory? You know, how serious is this woman? You know. She had a path to victory and she was able to do it. And because of that, she's doing the work she is. So thank you very much, Maria. You know, we were supportive of Morgan's early on too. And Morgan got some early money from us in the fall, just in part of the reason we did some of the early money was that we wanted to make sure if anybody was about to have a challenger who wanted to, we wanted to make sure they had enough money in the bank. So if you're looking to see if XYZ representative has any support, we wanted to make sure they had money in the bank. Morgan's one of those who, whenever we've needed her, she stepped up. She's been to a number of in-person friendraisers for us. And I'm always in awe of the things she's working on. She's working on a committee having to do with Black women's mortality, and just hearing that, you know, and I'm a mother of three. Teresa's a mother of three. I'm sure more of you have children. It's fascinating to listen to and to know that we have hardworking people like this working for the Commonwealth. You know, one of the subjects Teresa wanted to talk about today is what's going on with the budget. You know, we've got a reduced revenue because people aren't working because of this, and increased expenses. What's going to happen to the arts? What's going to happen to a lot of other programs? So I had two questions for Morgan. First, Morgan, please tell me it's made a difference this year to have more women, you know, this term, to have more women in office. And also, what's going on with the budget?
Two really big questions, but definitely can tackle them. So first and foremost, I do want to apologize to the senator for, you just came in at a time where you have COVID-19, a pandemic, civil unrest. I mean, you just had a partridge and a pear tree just hit you in your first term. I don't know how you're navigating it, but you're doing an amazing job. So first and foremost, I do want to, you know, just thank Represent PAC for just being one of my personal early investors in my first election. I'm in my second term, running for my third election. We age in dog years, so it's been, you know, some time. But back when I was running for the first time, I was actually not supported by the Democratic Party. I was one of five candidates, so we did have an uphill battle. And it was, when you're not supported by the Democratic Party, not many doors open. But thank you to the leadership of Christine and so many people on her team. They opened the door for me and really took a chance. So I will forever be grateful and just always make myself available to tell my story, but then to also encourage others to invest in progressive women. The second thing, Teresa, thank you so much for opening your home. Well, you know, kind of quasi opening your internet.
Yeah.
I think it's great. You don't have to worry about cleaning up or throwing away any food. So I think this works perfectly. So great, innovative way to do some fundraising. I think that's been one of the top questions now, like how are people transitioning their campaigns, you know, to virtual, and it, you know, you're doing an amazing job. So first and foremost, just thank the both of you. And to answer your question, having more women in the legislature makes a significant, huge difference. When you just look at the sweep that took place in 2018, we got a lot of amazing, energetic young women from the southeastern region and some from out west, really just changing the dynamics, changing the conversation. I swear, when I was in caucus one day and I got a chance to hear a lot of them, I was like, oh, I didn't know we can say things like that. they've really been just taking over, dictating what a new normal looks like in the General Assembly on the House side. And, you know, you really see that in the election of leadership. First time you see a woman as a chairwoman, with Joanna McClinton. You have HDCC, the chairwoman, literally taking the charge, delivering results on turning the House. I believe she raised more money than HDCC has ever with Leanne.
Leanne had to beg them to put her in as chair of that committee because they thought, well, you know, but we're really proud of Leanne because she was our first elected, the first person that we endorsed in her. She'd lost, and then she ran in a special, and she was our first win. So we take pride in that.
She is taking names and, bringing in a significant amount of money. I mean, listen, we're writing checks to her all the time just because we believe in her leadership. But you also have Donna Bullock, who became, you know, a part of the whip structure. You have Mary Jo Daly, who took over for the health caucus. Don't ask me why we had a man as a health caucus leader. That's a conversation for a different day. But we have Mary Jo leading that charge. And, when you look at the police reform that we were able to accomplish over these last couple of weeks, the person that developed the plan to take over the well of the House was Summer Lee, another woman coming out west that, you know, Represent PAC made an early investment in her. And we'll probably have to keep making investments in her because she's such a rebel rouser out there.
She's special. We did give her, we've given her quite a bit for her primary because that was a case where the Democratic Party was not endorsing the incumbent in her primary because after all, she didn't say Mother May I enough.
Yes, she is just coming in, guns blazing, and taking over houses. So, just with the level of leadership of women that we've had on the House side, it really dictates what the agenda looks like for the Democratic caucus. When you talk about women's issues, forget that we are a majority of the population here in Pennsylvania, so we really should be dictating what the agenda is and what the table is. But as you know, women are the fastest growing entrepreneurs. We are the fastest growing in owning businesses, fastest growing in obtaining secondary, post-secondary degrees, higher education, advanced degrees. I mean, we are, you know, leading the charge across so many aspects of society, but we also have significant challenges. I mean, as we've said constantly, we are the largest demographic making minimum wage. We are the fastest growing population in our prison system. We mentioned the issue of maternal mortality, the fact that our country is leading and ahead of so many underdeveloped countries in maternal mortality. I mean, these are the type of issues that we bring to the table, that we bring on our shoulders when we're coming up to Harrisburg. And we don't just come up to be present, we actually come up to see significant change and movement, because we see how this has a direct impact to the families that we're raising, to our neighbors. You know, women, we are just naturally community oriented, where we want to see everybody's quality of life succeed. And what's most critical about that is during a time like right now, like when we have the senator who's a nurse, who knew that a nurse actually knows what they're talking about when it comes to COVID-19. We've had so many Republicans over on the House side really trying to dictate to the secretary and to the governor their thoughts. And one of our colleagues had to mention, nobody is a physician in here. Where do you get this level of expertise or this level of arrogance that you can dictate policy based on partisanship? So I won't go off on that soapbox. But when you again look at women when it comes to COVID-19 and just how it's impacted us, I mean, majority of women are women in these fields, the professions that are our frontline workers, a majority of them are women. They're home health aides, they're healthcare workers, retailers, daycare center operators, teachers. So when you think of frontline representatives, oh, also, by the way, they're still getting paid less. But also, like, you know, the foundation of going to be able to help us navigate and keep communities safe and healthy, they are our frontline workers. And, you know, with that in mind, and so many women at the leadership table and so many firecrackers coming in 2018, we really were able to dictate financial investments in community. So that is the importance of having more women, progressive women with stories, with experiences, coming to Harrisburg, because when it comes time to spend $4.9 billion in COVID-19 funding in Pennsylvania, we are at those tables helping to make those decisions. Now, I must say that the Senate definitely led the charge. They got out their Democratic priorities financially when it came to COVID-19 funding prior to ours. So it kind of made our jobs easier, because we're just like, just do what the Senate is doing. They got it all right. We know we have some firecrackers over there. So I put together just a quick 3-point slide.
Yeah, Amy, if you want to bring those up.
Yep.
Just because it's a lot of numbers to digest, but this really speaks to the priority areas that, again, first came out of the Senate and, you know, had a lot of women that, again, were at the table to make these investments, make these decisions that really brought home dollars to help protect communities during this time. And again, we're dealing with COVID-19. You had the civil unrest as a result of the police brutality issues that have been happening, and an economic downturn. So just very high level, didn't want to be too formal, but I just, you know, I'm a visual learner, and that's how I'll be just able to tell you what numbers look like. So as you know, Commonwealth of Pennsylvania received $4.9 billion in COVID-19 funding from the feds. A billion of those dollars went to seven counties directly. If you had a population over 500,000, then you were able to get a direct allotment. So when you think of Montco, when you think of Philadelphia, Bucks, those are some of the areas that got direct allotments. It didn't take them out of the process of getting additional dollars, but they just got direct payments from the Fed, similar to some of the hospitals. As you know, universities got direct allotments. So of that $4.9 billion, $2.6 billion was discretionary funding. And this is where we've got an opportunity to work collaboratively with the Senate Dems to talk about what are our priorities. And the great thing is when you have women that are a part of the appropriations conversation on both the House and the Senate side, you have ability to drive dollars to what's most important to you in the community. Some of the top priorities included education funding. So when you think of our K-12 operations being required to move to digital platforms, they needed dollars. This money also incorporated higher education institutions. Like I can imagine so many on this call, student loan debt was a big issue. And how people are going to be able to pay their mortgage payments. So a lot of that money as it related to education was included in what we were able to secure, close to over $347 million. Another big piece was small businesses. As I said earlier, women, fastest growing entrepreneurs, we needed to make that investment, especially in businesses that were forced to close throughout the entire time, all the way to, you know, the green phase. So we were able to secure $225 million. Rental and mortgage assistance. Evictions are something that everybody's watching. As soon as our courts are open, a lot of us are concerned to see if a lot of people are going to be forced to be evicted from their homes. So we were able to secure $175 million. Worker safety. I talked to you about frontline workers being, you know, a good portion of them being women and needing to have PPE, needing to have access to what they needed, hazardous pay. To think that hazardous pay was a big fight, you wouldn't believe. Again, long-term living programs. As you know, a lot of our senior facilities, our nursing facilities, were really hotbeds and weren't really prepared, in my opinion, to really protect residents. And last but not least, I know there was a question around arts and culture. There was a fund created, $20 million secure for cultural and museum preservation. To ensure that they are able to stay on their feet during these difficult times. So those were some of the top priorities for us. But then, right after COVID-19, we have a bit of a stopgap budget to deal with revenues declining both on the city level, local level, state level, federal level, across the country. We really had to figure it out and how do we survive over the next 5 months waiting for our tax revenues to rebound. So I'm sure you've heard this really scary number. It scares me every day. $6 billion worth of a revenue shortfall for a two-year period, which again forced us to do a stopgap budget where we spent $25.8 billion. But we still, you know, have some months left to go to fund to end this fiscal year. And we have to come up with $5.5 billion for the remainder of the fiscal year. But one of the great things, although everything was flat funded, we were able to get a year-round funding allotment for K-12 and higher education, because as you know, they have to be able to predict what they're going to be able to get. And, you know, this isn't a conversation for city local property taxes. I'll leave that to my city council members. But last but not least, unfortunately, there were no new initiatives funded that the governor proposed at the top of the budget season, but also no new taxes. So even though we do have significant challenges, we were able to get that level funding piece, but we will have our work cut out for us over the next several months. And the next slide are just some of the looming pressures that you can imagine that we'll have in November. So of course, you know, paying our debt services, I mean, that doesn't go anywhere. Being able to protect pre-K, pre-K all the way to 12, especially our higher education. This is going to be a new normal, a new reality for systems across the Commonwealth. And again, we have to talk about new revenue sources. We can't keep having this conversation about Marcellus Shell that is just not, that industry just not being taxed, but sucking the life out of Pennsylvania, but also damaging environmental areas across the Commonwealth. So, I mean, we have a lot of significant challenges ahead of us. But I think, again, the importance of having more women at the table is that we recognize that we have to lead with and be outcome driven. We can't do things in smoke-filled rooms where we're not protecting families and ensuring families are our top priority as we move forward. And I think the way that we need that will help us the most to do that, we won't be making any more budget decisions until after the election. For some reason, the Republicans, you know, designed it that way. So it'll be great to have more women come in during the election to help us make these decisions and help us make the right and smart decisions. Because one thing I'll tell you about the women up in Harrisburg, we want to see a new normal in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, but we also know that new normal has to be built with an equitable lens that touches all communities. And that's one thing that Represent PEC does. And I'll close here, because with their early investment, the fact that they have this financial goal but want to increase it means they want to get access to more candidates and make sure that they're successful. So I cannot thank you enough for always thinking of me to come preach to the choir about the importance of early investments and ensuring that people are at the table so we can drive policy into our politics and really flip the House and the Senate. So we're not having as harder conversations as we've been having during this time period. So I'll stop there and just say thank you.
Thank you, Morgan. You know, one of the things that when Morgan was talking reminded me of a story that Madeleine Dean, who's now a member of Congress, when Madeleine came into the to be a state rep, she was told, okay, dear, you have to sit and be quiet for your first couple terms because you'll get used to what's going on. You don't want to speak up too much because you don't want to be thought of as that kind of woman. You want to just kind of go along and get along. And if you know Madeleine, that was very hard for her to do. And what I love about so many of it, it's like the story that, you know, two women on a corporate board, they feel intimidated because, you know, there aren't many women. Three or more, they feel open. We've got enough women in leadership and in good positions, and they're good progressive women. We have some good progressive men too, but a number of the women have decided not to go along to get along, and they're making sure their voices are heard. And you guys watch out. We got a bunch more uppity women coming through our process this time of women who really want to join you and make a difference.